So today, the theme of the city of the talk today of the Haskolloquium, this is part of the series of the Haskolloquia. The theme of today's colloquium is the city, and SUTD, both because we host the Lipa New Center for Innovative Cities, and because of the vocation of our university that is centered on design, technology, and architecture, the city is a theme that for us is very important. Usually we look at this theme from a more technical point of view, an architectural and urbanistic point of view, but today we'll look at the same theme from a more theoretical, so to say, point of view, that is to say, from the point of view of philosophy. We have two guests from Italy. The first one is Professor Giuseppe Girgenti. Professor Girgenti is Professor of History of Ancient Philosophy at the Università San Raffaele of Milan. He's a specialist of the Platonic and Neoplatonic tradition, as well as of patristics. He has translated and edited several works of ancient authors such as Plato, Plotinus, Porphyry, Iamblichus, Proclus, as well as works of Christian authors of the first centuries of Christianity, such as St. Augustine, Justin, and Origen. He has recently published a book, the title of which in Italian is Atene e Gerusalemme, una fusione di orizzonti, Athens and Jerusalem, a fusion of horizons, published in 2011. And he's gonna talk about the concept of the city in the ancient world, in particular in the Greco-Roman world. So his intervention is gonna focus on the polis, and in particular on the emanational, I would say, with a Neoplatonic term, nature of the ancient city, whereby many of the ancient Greek cities reproduced themselves through colonies that were quite different from the colonies that the Europeans will spread around the world after the discovery of the New World of the Americas, colonies that were in fact independent entities that enter into a dialectical relationship with the city of origin. So he's going to talk to us about the concept of polis and metropolis. Metropolis understood etymologically as mother city, and will help us understand what kind of not only political but also social reality, and hence cultural reality, the ancient city was. The other guest speaker is Dr. Diego Fusaro, who is a researcher in philosophy at the Università San Raffaele of Milan. They work in the same department. He's a specialist of Marx and German idealism, as well as of what he likes to define as Italian theory, that is to say, philosophers such as Giovanni Gentile, the work of whom is one of those scholars who are helping to bring back to the fore after 70 years of damnatio memoriae, we would say. So Gentile on the one hand and Antonio Gramsci on the other. He's a quite prolific author, even though he's very young. He has written already several books, some of which have stirred quite a debate, not only in Italy, but also outside of Italy, chiefly, I think, in France and in Spain. Some of his books are, quoting them in chronological order, starting from the earlier one, Bentornato Marx, Welcome Back Marx. The title is already quite eloquent. He somehow thinks that Marx is an author that we have to start looking at again quite carefully in order to understand our reality. And this book is of 2009. The other book, Essere senza tempo, Accelerazione della storia e della vita, Being without time, Acceleration of history and life, the reference to Heidegger is quite open here, Essere senza tempo, being without time, instead of being in time. And I think that this, from this perspective, or this book published in 2010, that is gonna start this contribution today. And then two other books, Minima Mercatalia, Filosofia e Capitalismo, Philosophy and Capitalism, 2012. And the last one that just came out of the print, Il futuro è nostro, Filosofia dell'azione, Future is ours, Philosophy of Action. Diego will talk about the modern form of the city, in particular in his declension since the dawn of capitalism, that is to say the global metropolis, and will start his reflection from the analysis of the metropolis conducted by Georg Simmel in his essay Metropolis and Mental Life, and he will use also other essays of Simmel to then open up the question of where are we now in our experience of the city in relation to the analysis that Simmel had put forth now more than 100 years ago. After them, I myself will briefly contribute something in the way of, I hope, maybe at once a summing up and a provocation maybe to open up the floor for more questions. And I hope that in this respect Mike can be our main agent provocateur. Let's see if we can manage to create a round table, which is not round, that doesn't end up in amicable and self-celebratory speeches, but maybe brings us not to fight, but to get out of here with some doubts rather than reaffirmations of old certainties. Now, they're gonna give their contributions in Italian, and I will translate them as they go. So be patient with me. I can guarantee you that their Italian is perfect, and my English won't be, I think, a very nice mirror of their very good Italian. So feel free to stop me whenever you don't get something that I say, and I'll be glad to repeat. Now, maybe we should use also this one. So, Giuseppe will start first, and I will translate. No, I have another.
Good evening to everybody. I'm very glad and grateful for this invitation here at the Singapore University of Technology and Design. And I'm very glad to see here distinguished colleagues, dear students, and Paolo Di Leo, who invited us. First of all, I apologize for speaking in Italian. I can also speak in English, but we discussed and decided together that it's better to speak in Italian for the reason that our English is not so fluent, and that's not the first reason. The second reason is that so we can express our thought in a better way, and perhaps you can appreciate a foreign language as Italian that it's not known over the world. So, l'argomento di cui parlerò è il tema della città e della città madre, polis e metropolis nel mondo antico.
So the argument about which I'm going to talk is that of the city and of the mother city in the ancient world.
Il termine greco polis letteralmente significa città, e il termine da esso derivato metropolis letteralmente significa città madre.
So the Greek term polis literally means city, and the other term derived from it, to say metropolis, means literally mother city.
In termini generali, una metropoli è una città molto grande, una città più grande, mentre le città figlie, le città derivate dalla città madre, cioè le sue colonie, sono più piccole, e nel mondo antico queste colonie, rispetto alla Grecia, si diffusero sia nell'Oriente, nella penisola anatolica, sia nell'Occidente, cioè nel Sud Italia e nella Sicilia.
So, generally speaking, the metropolis is bigger as for its extension, whereas its colonies are smaller. And throughout the history of Greek civilization, Greek colonies spread both in the east, in Anatolia, nowadays Turkey, and in the west, in nowadays southern Italy, the ancient Magna Graecia.
Alcune coordinate storiche e geografiche. Stiamo parlando della Grecia antica dall'VIII secolo al IV secolo avanti Cristo.
So some historical and geographical coordinates. We're talking about ancient Greece from the 8th century to the 2nd century AD, BC. Sorry.
La Grecia nel mondo antico non fu mai uno stato nel senso moderno, ma ogni città fu essa stessa una città-stato, ed è il termine con cui di solito viene tradotto polis.
So Greece in its ancient history has never formed a state, a unitarian state, but each city was in and of itself a state, that is to say a city-state. And that's usually the term with which the ancient Greek polis is translated, that is to say city-state.
Possiamo fare due esempi. Uno è l'Italia medievale, che non fu mai uno stato unitario, solo nel XIX secolo si raggiunse l'unità statuale dell'Italia, ma fu appunto un agglomerato di repubbliche marinare e di comuni, ognuno dei quali era appunto una città-stato.
We can draw a parallel with medieval Italy that has never been a unitarian state. The unity of the nation was reached only in the 19th century, but instead was an ensemble of sea republics and of free comuni, free states, free city-states.
Forse voi potete comprendere meglio quest'idea per il fatto che Singapore è una città-stato.
So maybe you can grasp this idea quite well, given the fact that Singapore is a city-state.
Però nella Grecia antica ogni città-stato, ogni metropoli, istituì una rete, un network di relazioni con le sue colonie, cioè con le sue città figlie.
However, the difference with ancient Greece is that in ancient Greece, every city-state, every metropolis, created a network of relations with the various colonies that generated from it.
Dal termine greco polis derivano tutti i termini moderni come politica, polizia, ma anche la riflessione dei più grandi filosofi greci come Platone e Aristotele si indirizzò al tema della polis in opere come la Politeia di Platone, che appunto deriva da polis, la repubblica, e come la Politica di Aristotele, che è appunto intesa come una politica e tecne, un'arte politica.
So from the very name polis and from the reality that it represented, terms that we still use, such as politics or even police, are derived, but more importantly, from the reality of the city was derived the reflection of great Greek philosophy, two examples of which can be Plato and Aristotle. Plato, who immediately addressed his philosophical reflection to the theme of the city in a work, for example, to name just one, Politeia, the Republic, Politeia, and Aristotle, who writes the treatise on politics.
Sia Platone sia Aristotele descrivono le forme storiche, cioè le costituzioni delle città greche antiche, che furono di varia natura: monarchia, tirannide, aristocrazia, oligarchia, democrazia o forma corrotta della democrazia che noi oggi chiameremmo demagogia.
Both Plato and Aristotle have described the various political forms that could take hold in a polis. So monarchy, aristocracy, tyranny, democracy, oligarchy, down to the degeneration of democracy that could be called demagogy.
Platone in particolare descrive come è nata la città, come nella Grecia, a partire dal periodo più arcaico, si è formato questo agglomerato umano che è nello stesso tempo antropologico, geografico, culturale, storico e appunto politico.
So Plato in particular describes how the city came to be in the beginning, describing thus the way in which this this gathering of human beings happened, a gathering that is also the base for an anthropology, that is to say, it involves aspects that are social, religious, cultural, historical, geographical and anthropological.
Attingendo alle fonti storiografiche come Erodoto, Tucidide, ma anzitutto anche ai poemi omerici più arcaici, possiamo dire che la più antica polis della Grecia sia stata Sparta nel Peloponneso.
So if we look back at the historiographical sources such as, for example, Herodotus, but also the Athenian Thucydides, we can probably assert that the most ancient city settlement in Greece has been Sparta in the Peloponnese.
Di Sparta abbiamo notizia già dai poemi omerici e in particolare dall'Iliade, dove troviamo questa città insieme ad Argo come un agglomerato di tribù, di villaggi rette da un re, appunto da un basileus, l'antica Basileia Micenea. Il termine greco basileus a volte è anche vanax oppure anax, dove il re è coadiuvato da un gruppo di anziani consiglieri che lo aiutano nelle decisioni più gravi, come quelle di fare una guerra.
So already in the Iliad, so in Homer, we find mentions of this political reality, Sparta, that back then was an ensemble of villages, all held together by a king, or in Greek, Basileus. Basileus that is an ancient Mycenaean term, together with Anax or Vanax. And this king did not rule alone, but was surrounded by an assembly of elders who helped him take the most important decisions, such, for example, going to war.
Un altro termine, oltre a Basileus e Vanax per indicare il re, è il termine tiranno, che oggi noi usiamo con accezione negativa, ma che nell'epoca più antica non aveva questa accezione negativa.
Another term to refer to the king, to the Basileus, is the term tyrant, tyrannos in Greek, that nowadays we use and perceive in a negative acceptation, but in ancient times was not perceived as such.
Per esempio, ancora nella tragedia di Edipo, il re Edipo viene chiamato Oedipus Tyrannus, Oedipus Rex, Oedipus Rex, Edipo Re.
For example, in the Sophoclean tragedy, Oedipus, who was a king, is called Oedipus the Tyrant.
Per spiegare l'origine della polis, gli storici moderni utilizzano il termine sinecismo, dal greco synoikia, cioè aggregazione di tribù.
So to explain the origin of the Greek polis, modern historians use the term synecism, that is to say a term derived from the Greek syn and oikia, this aggregation of tribes.
Ecco, questo è importante per capire anche l'etimologia del termine polis. Il termine synoikia già dà conto di una molteplicità di tribù, oikiai, che si unificano, syn, che vengono insieme. Il termine polis ha a che fare con polus, che in greco indica appunto una molteplicità.
So this is important, keeping in mind this etymology, this definition is important because it helps us understand the very meaning of the word polis itself. That is to say, polis is the result of the unity of a plurality, syn oikie, that is to say, tribes oikie, that get syn together. Hence, polis has in itself the idea of plurality.
E allora il problema è capire che tipo di unità cerca questa molteplicità di individui che si accomunano sotto regole comuni, accordi comuni, leggi comuni.
So then the problem becomes then to understand what kind of unity this multiplicity of individuals can look for and find, this multiplicity of individuals that decide to gather around common rights, common beliefs, common laws, common customs.
Questo problema del rapporto tra unità e molteplicità, così astrattamente posto, in Platone diventa la chiave di volta per comprendere la sua idea di una città buona.
So this problem of the relation between unity and multiplicity, put in this very abstract way, becomes in Plato the key point to understand the possibility of the idea of the foundation of what he calls a good city.
Possiamo dire che per Platone tutto ciò che porta all'unità è buono, tutto ciò che porta alla divisione è cattivo.
So we can say that for Plato whatever brings about unity is good, whereas whatever brings about division is evil.
Naturalmente si tratta di una unità articolata, di una identità all'interno di differenze, di una comunità fatta di individui, di un bene comune che deve garantire i beni individuali.
Of course, we're dealing with a unity that is characterized by the fact of being an articulated unity, a community made up of individuals, and a community that is such insofar as it is able to provide for the good of each individual in diversity.
Se analizziamo la monarchia e la democrazia da questo punto di vista, troveremo che nella monarchia governa uno solo su molti, quindi c'è la massima unità politica, ma la minima uguaglianza tra i sudditi. D'altro canto, se analizziamo la democrazia, troveremo la massima uguaglianza tra i cittadini, ma la minima unità politica.
So if we compare on the one hand monarchy and on the other democracy, we would find that in these two systems there are two different polarizations. In monarchy we have where just one individual governs, rules. We have in monarchy the highest political unity, but the minimum of individual equality. Whereas in democracy is the exact contrary. We have the minimum of political unity, but the maximum of individual equality.
Questo problema ci porta a un'altra considerazione, cioè il fatto che l'unità nella molteplicità deve essere sempre pensata come misura, metron in greco.
So this problem brings us to another consideration, namely that the relation between unity and multiplicity must be thought of in terms of measure, or to use the Greek term, metron.
La misura è principio di ordine e perciò stesso principio di bene. La dismisura, al contrario, è principio di disordine e perciò stesso di male.
Measure or metron is a principle of order, and because of this very fact is a principle of good, whereas lack of measure is for this is a principle of disorder, and for this very reason it's a source of evil.
Misura è anche principio di bellezza, non solo di bene. Quindi una città buona deve essere da un lato misurata, cioè avere un numero limitato di abitanti in modo che si possano conoscere tutti tra di loro, e dall'altro lato non deve essere illimitata dal punto di vista territoriale.
So measure is not only a moral the generator of moral good, but also of aesthetic good, in that measure is the generator of beauty. So a good city doesn't have only to be unlimited in the sense that it doesn't have to be too big, but contain only a few citizens so that they can all know each other, but shouldn't be unlimited either from the space point of view, shouldn't be unbounded.
Adesso introduciamo un altro termine per capire il rapporto tra polis e metropolis, cioè il termine apoikia, correlativo al termine synoikia.
Now we introduce another term to understand the reality of the polis and in its dialectical polarization of unity and multiplicity, that is to say the term apoikia, which is in a way correlated and opposed to the term synoikia.
Synoikia e apoikia, cioè la città e le sue colonie, sono come sistole e diastole del mondo politico greco antico, ovvero una forza centripeta e una forza centrifuga.
So Synoikia and Apoikia, so the mother city Synoikia and Apoikia, its colony, are in a way like the two movements of the heart in Greek civilization.
Il cuore che batte.
You know how the heart does. That goes out and in. Yeah.
Una forza centripeta e una centrifuga.
Yeah. Centrifugal and a centripetal force. So centrifugal in that it pushes waves out of the mother city, but then it calls them back in a way.
Questo lo dico perché la metropolis greca non è da intendere come una città molto grande, quella fu semmai la megalopoli, ma la metropoli fu sempre la città madre di una serie di città figlie, cioè le colonie a oriente e occidente.
I want to stress this fact because the Greek metropolis is not to be understood as a big polis, as a big city, as a humongous city. That was maybe in later age the megalopolis. But the metropolis was rather the mother of a series of colonies that spread both in the east and in the west of the Mediterranean.
La apoikia, cioè la colonia, venne fondata da un oikistes, cioè da un fondatore di colonie, che però istituiva una nuova polis che avrebbe mantenuto l'autonomia, l'indipendenza e l'autogoverno rispetto alla metropolis.
So the apoikia, the colony, was founded by an oikistes, to say, founder. And this colony, even though it was in relation with the metropolis, with the original city, would have maintained throughout his life autonomy, political independence and self-governance.
Spesso i fondatori delle città furono anche legislatori, nomoteti, cioè elaborarono un sistema di leggi diverse a seconda delle città per regolare questa nuova associazione umana.
So very often the founders of cities, the Kistes, were also those who wrote down the laws. They were nomothetes, that is to say, makers of laws. In that sense, each of them regulated the city he founded in a different way from all the other cities.
Facciamo tre esempi, le più importanti polis greche della Grecia continentale, cioè Sparta e Atene, ebbero come rispettivi nomoteti Licurgo per Sparta e Solone per Atene.
To make three examples, the two main cities of mainland Greece, Sparta and Athens, had respectively as their nomothetes, as their legislators, Lycurgus in Sparta and Solon in Athens.
Per fare invece due esempi di apoikia, di colonie, possiamo pensare a Caronda, legislatore di Catania, colonia della Sicilia, o a Pittaco di Mitilene nell'isola di Lesbo.
To make two examples of two colonies, we can think of Carondas, who has been the legislator of Catania in Sicily, and Pittaco, who instead has been the legislator of Mitilene on the island of Lesbos.
I due casi di Sparta e Atene, cioè le legislazioni di Licurgo e di Solone, rispecchiano però una concezione della polis profondamente diversa e per certi versi antitetica.
The two legislations, that of Sparta and Athens, so that of Lycurgus and Solon, are the reflection though of two quite different conceptions of public life and hence of the polis.
Detto molto sinteticamente, la costituzione antica di Sparta fu un'oligarchia di tipo militare divisa in tre classi rigidamente strutturate, dove solo la classe dominante, gli Spartiati, godeva dei pieni diritti. La classe dominata, gli Iloti, cioè i servi della gleba, non avevano alcun diritto civile.
So, to put it in a few words, the legislation of Sparta was made so that society would be divided into three rigid classes, and the society itself was an oligarchy. But these three rigid classes were divided in such a way that at the top there would be the Spartiates, that is to say those who had all the political powers, and at the bottom the Iloti, who were less than servants, with no rights whatsoever.
All'interno della classe dominante, cioè degli Spartiati, vigeva il principio della uguaglianza. Erano gli uguali, la comunità degli homoioi.
So within the dominating class, the Spartiates, the principle that reigned was the principle of equality. They formed the society of equals, the homoi in Greek.
Questa uguaglianza era sostanziale, divisione della terra in parti uguali, divisione del denaro in parti uguali, pasti consumati in comune, sussidiari. Non circolavano monete né d'oro né d'argento, ma solo di ferro e anche abbastanza grandi, proprio per evitare qualunque desiderio di accumulo di ricchezza.
So this equality was not nominal but substantial. That is to say, it was based on the equal division of land, equal division of tasks, equal division of money, of wealth, on the fact that the equals had to eat together, the sissitiae, the lunches together, and there was no gold or silver currency, but only iron coins, and even in their very physical form, these coins were quite big, so that they wouldn't engender the desire to accumulate them and to take them around.
Al contrario, la Costituzione antica di Atene fu ispirata al principio della libertà, non dell'uguaglianza.
On the other hand, the constitution, the ancient constitution of Athens, was based not on the principle of equality, but on the principle of freedom.
Già in un atto politico di Solone, la seisachteia fu la liberazione dalla schiavitù acquisita per debito.
Already one of the most important political acts of Solon was the seisachteia, that is to say, the liberation from slavery, a slavery that one had fallen into because of debts.
Quindi la libertà, l'eleutheria, è il principio guida dell'ateniese, però è una libertà che trova il suo limite nella legge, nel nomos. E se c'è uguaglianza dei cittadini ateniesi, è un'uguaglianza non sostanziale ma formale, cioè uguaglianza di fronte alla legge, in greco isonomia.
So, the principle of freedom, in Greek eleutheria, appears thus to be the guiding principle of the Athenian man, an eleutheria, a freedom that has to respond only and to be limited only by nomos, by the law, but this freedom of the Athenian citizen is not substantial freedom, like it, substantial equality and freedom, hence as it was for the Spartan, but a freedom that is substantiated only within the limits of the law.
La differenza delle classi sociali ad Atene era basata sul censo, sulla distribuzione della ricchezza, per cui a livello più alto c'erano i possessori di 500 medimni di grano, pentacosio medimni. Al secondo livello i possessori di 300 medimni di grano, triacosio medimni o cavalieri, e via via gli zeugiti, coloro che si potevano permettere una coppia di buoi per arare il terreno, fino ai nullatenenti, cioè i tetti. Naturalmente la divisione non era rigida, se uno si arricchiva saliva di grado, se uno si impoveriva scendeva di grado.
So the division of Athenian society was based on census. At the top there were the pentacosio medimni, that is to say those who possessed 500 medimni of grain. Under them the triacosio medimni, those who possessed only 300 medimni of grain. Then the zevigites, that is to say those who were able to afford for themselves a couple of oxen to plow the field. And under this the tetis, that is to say the those who didn't possess anything. Now, we have to stress the fact that this division was not rigid, but if one managed to become richer, he could climb up in the social scale, while the other way around, if he lost his wealth, he would go down.
Questo significa che Atene fu una democrazia progressivamente istituita, basata soprattutto sul commercio e sulla ricchezza. Al contrario, Sparta fu un'oligarchia militare la cui grandezza, la cui espansione si basò soprattutto sulla guerra.
So this means that Athens has been a democracy that progressively established itself and flourished on trade and wealth and commerce, whereas Sparta was an oligarchy that managed to expand itself and become stronger only through war.
Sparta fu soprattutto una potenza di terra. Atene fu soprattutto una potenza di mare, con il commercio e con la navigazione.
So Sparta has been most of all a land power, whereas Athens has been characteristically a sea power.
Nella storiografia moderna, soprattutto per coloro che amano le analogie, di solito in Europa si paragona Atene alla Gran Bretagna, al Regno Unito, Sparta alla Germania, o se andiamo avanti, Sparta più alla Russia e Atene più all'America.
In modern historiography, for those historians who like analogies, usually Athens is compared to the United Kingdom, whereas Sparta is compared to Germany, or if we go further ahead in history, Athens is compared to the United States of America, whereas Sparta is compared to Russia.
Però se qualcosa accomuna Atene, Sparta e le altre polis greche del mondo antico è il fatto che la città, la polis, costituisce lo spazio etico, religioso e filosofico comune e al di sopra di ogni cittadino, che quindi è un uomo cittadino.
But if there is a common trait that allows us to look at the various Greek city-states as one phenomenon, is the fact that the polis represents a common space that is a religious, an ethical, and a philosophical space wherein each individual is, insofar as it is, a citizen.
Un filosofo filologo tedesco, Max Polenz, in un'opera sull'uomo greco, ha sostenuto che la città, la polis greca, ha un valore religioso pari agli dèi e al destino.
A German philosopher and philologist, Max Polenz, in a book on the Greek men, sustains that the Greek polis has for the Greek men the same value that is ascribed to the gods and to destiny.
Questo significa che la città ha anche una valenza religiosa, c'è una teologia politica, politiche teologia, che nella urbanistica concreta si realizza nei templi, nel teatro e nelle strutture di culto che regolano la vita quotidiana della polis.
So this means that the city, concretely speaking, has a religious value and because of this it generates a political theology, that is to say in Greek, a politiki theologia, which in the very urban setting of the city manifests itself in the temples, in the theaters, in the squares, and in all those structures that shape the common life of the citizens within the city.
Il teatro ha una valenza religiosa, è una sorta di autorappresentazione collettiva del destino stesso della città.
So theater, for example, has a religious value. In that, it's a can be looked at as a sort of self-representation of the city itself and its destiny.
Naturalmente il tempio di solito posto nell'acropoli, cioè nella parte alta della città, dove viene onorato il dio patrono, il nume tutelare, la dea Atena nel caso di Atene.
And of course the temple that usually is built on the highest point of the city, the Acropolis, in which is venerated the god or the goddess who protects the given city. In the case of Athens, the goddess Athena.
Yes, for the time. Yeah, how much time do you have?
Oh, 5 minutes. So I go to the end. Questi due modelli, Atene e Sparta, necessariamente entrarono in conflitto e determinarono la catastrofe della Grecia classica nella guerra del Peloponneso.
So these two models, as it is very well known, at a certain point entered into conflict and determined the catastrophe of classical Greece during the war of Peloponnese.
Platone, che scrive alla fine della guerra del Peloponneso tra Atene e Sparta, nella sua Politeia si sforzò di elaborare un modello politico guidato dai filosofi che però tenesse insieme contemporaneamente il modello spartano, la classe dei guerrieri, e il modello ateniese, la classe dei commercianti.
So Plato wrote after the catastrophe of the Peloponnesian War made the effort to produce a model that would be able to keep together these two options, that is to say, to build a city that would embrace at once the warrior class of Sparta and the philosophical culture of Athens.
Nell'immediato il tentativo platonico fu fallimentare, però nel corso della storia occidentale successiva fu ripreso da numerosi autori cristiani, rinascimentali, basta pensare alla Città di Dio di Agostino, all'Utopia di Tommaso Moro, alla Città del Sole di Tommaso Campanella.
So, right after the composition of the Republic and during the life of Plato, the Platonic attempt has been a failure. However, this model as an aspiration survived throughout the entirety of Western philosophical speculation. We might think, for example, of St. Augustine's City of God, of Thomas More's Utopia, of Campanella's The City of the Sun.
Nel periodo in cui visse Platone e poi Aristotele, assistiamo invece a una fine della polis come modello politico, con l'impresa di Alessandro Magno, che conquistando l'intera Grecia e l'intero mondo orientale, allora sotto il dominio persiano, e anche l'Egitto e il Medio Oriente, di fatto istituì una monarchia universale sconfinata.
After Plato and Aristotle, we see the end of the Greek political world, in particular with the figure of Alexander the Great, who, after conquering all the lands at east that were back then under the domination of the Persians, and conquering also Egypt and what we call nowadays the Middle East, brought about a universal monarchy.
Questo forse è il primo esempio di globalizzazione nel mondo antico, cioè la ellenizzazione, la diffusione della cultura greca, della lingua greca, della religione greca, dei modelli greci a popolazioni allora considerate barbare o barbariche e quindi originariamente non greche.
This is the first example, maybe in the ancient world, of what we call nowadays globalization. That is to say, the spreading and the imposition to un-Greek people, then called barbarians, of a lifestyle, of a culture and of a language typical of Greek culture.
Il secondo esempio di globalizzazione fu naturalmente quella romana, la romanizzazione, ma in entrambi i casi abbiamo la fine del modello della città misurata e limitata.
The second case of globalization in the ancient world was, has been of course, the Roman Empire, the romanization of the Mediterranean, with the unlimited spreading of the power of Rome, but in both cases we have the end of the experiment of the city-state, that is to say, of that limited form of self-governance.
Concludo con questa idea. La fine del modello greco di polis portò a due fenomeni etici uguali e contrari, le due facce della stessa medaglia. Cioè, da un lato, la riduzione dello spazio etico all'individuo, l'individualismo della filosofia epicurea, del giardino di Epicuro, e dall'altro lato l'espansione del modello della polis al mondo intero, all'intero cosmo, quello che si chiama appunto cosmopolis, cosmopolitismo, e quindi la ricerca di una legge universale, di una ragione universale, di uno stile di vita universale.
So I want to conclude my intervention with a consideration. The end of the reality of the polis brought about two phenomena that are at once parallel and opposite to each other, that are the reversal of each other. On the one hand, the beginning of an individualistic kind of morality and lifestyle. We can think of, for example, Epicureanism and the Garden of Epicurus and his search for individual happiness. On the other hand, the imposition all over the world, on the rest of the world, of the model of the polis, and thus the research of a common universal reason, of a common universal norm that would be valid for everybody and everywhere and anywhere.
Per concludere con un'idea platonica, queste due tensioni, l'individualismo verso l'interiorità, il cosmopolitismo verso l'intero mondo, sono entrambi smarrimenti del concetto di misura, di metron, tipico invece della polis classica.
To conclude with a Platonic thought, these two movements, individualism closed within itself on the one hand, and cosmopolitanism, this opening up, this unlimited opening up to the rest of the world, are both the result of the loss of the classical idea of limit, of measure, that of metron, that governed the reality of the Greek polis.
Con questo vi ringrazio per l'attenzione.
With this, I thank you for your attention. Thank you, Giuseppe, for your intervention, which has been very, very fruitful and stimulating, above all because I think it will allow us to have a nice transition to Diego's intervention, exactly right on this idea of the metron, of the limit, of the measure, which is constituent of the heart of the city. I think that it's better if we go directly to Diego, then maybe I'll say a few words, and we can open up then the floor for discussion. I see that l'agent provocateur is taking a lot of notes. I hope they're going to be quite pointy and provocative. Okay, so.
Good evening to everybody. It's an honor for me to be here at the University of Singapore. I will speak in my language because of a theoretical reason, so to say. I think that in philosophy and in literature, the form cannot be separated from the content, as Nietzsche said. So I think it's better if I speak in my language.
As long as it isn't Vietnamese, but Italian.
Yes, of course. The topic of my contribution is the concept of Großstadt, megalopolis, or big city, started from Georg Simmel. Il mio intervento si propone di esplorare fenomenologicamente alcune prerogative della moderna metropoli a partire dalle considerazioni del saggio del sociologo e filosofo tedesco Georg Simmel, espresse nel suo testo Die Großstädte und das Geistesleben del 1903.
So my intervention has as its aim to explore certain characteristics of modern metropolis, starting from the considerations put together by the German sociologist and philosopher Georg Simmel in his famous essay Metropolis and Mental Life of 1903.
Si tratta di un testo che, nonostante le molteplici trasformazioni cui sono andate incontro le forme e le strutture delle metropoli, permette tuttora di gettare una luce su alcuni degli aspetti fondamentali della metropoli moderna e contemporanea in quanto tale.
So it's a text that, although the many transformations that metropolis have undergone in the past 100 years, still allows us to shed some light on certain phenomena that remain core in the formation and hence in the understanding of the reality of metropolis.
Di più, come cercherò di mostrare nella parte conclusiva del mio intervento, Simmel precorre con lungimiranza alcuni aspetti che solo nella metropoli cosmopolitica odierna si sono pienamente realizzati.
Moreover, as I will try to point out in my conclusion, Simmel underlines certain aspects that find their full accomplishment only in the present state of metropolis.
Non dimentichiamo del resto che Simmel continua a costituire ad oggi un passaggio obbligato per tutti gli studiosi che abbiano in passato o che vogliano oggi affrontare il tema della metropoli. Pensiamo anche solo alle analisi di Walter Benjamin e di Siegfried Krakauer.
We have also to keep in mind that Simmel has represented and keeps representing a necessary passage for all those scholars who want to analyze the reality of metropolis even today. We may think of two great scholars of the past, such as Krakauer and Benjamin.
Quindi svolgerò ora alcune considerazioni seguendo da vicino il testo di Simmel e poi proverò a ragionare sull'odierna metropoli cosmopolitica andando anche oltre Simmel.
So I will first develop certain considerations based on the text of Simmel, and I will then try to go beyond Simmel, analyzing the reality of the metropolis nowadays.
Come è noto, il saggio di Simmel sulla metropoli non si sofferma tanto sulle strutture, magari sulle strutture urbane della metropoli, ma piuttosto sugli atteggiamenti, sulla sociologia operante all'interno della metropoli.
So, as it is very well known, the essay of Simmel on metropolis doesn't stress so much the physical and the urban structures of the metropolis, but rather it stresses the attitudes, the ways of life that take place in the metropolis.
Questo peraltro è del tutto coerente con l'atteggiamento sociologico-filosofico di Simmel, che si pone sempre come, per così dire, pittore della vita spirituale e delle forme della vita moderna.
This, however, is in line with Simmel's general approach, who, as a philosopher and a sociologist, understands himself as sort of painter of the tendencies of modern life.
È significativo che in occasione della scomparsa di Simmel, il filosofo Georgi Lukács volle presentarlo come il filosofo dell'impressionismo, come il Monet della filosofia.
It is in this sense quite telling the fact that right after Simmel passed away, the philosopher Lukács represented him, spoke about him as the impressionist of philosophy, as the Monet of philosophy.
E in effetti Lukács ha ragione. Nelle opere di Simmel e anche nel saggio sulla Metropolis si ha la sensazione di una perenne mancanza di centro, come se a Simmel interessasse il frammento e non la totalità.
And we can say that Lukács was overall right, because in the works of Simmel we do perceive a lack of center, so to say, as if Simmel were more interested into the fragments rather than in grasping the totality.
Infatti, il saggio sulla Metropoli del 1903 si sofferma su una serie di immagini evocative legate alla vita spirituale della città moderna che permettono di comprenderne in maniera frammentata, per così dire, il significato generale.
And in fact, the essay on Metropolis and Mental Life pays attention to certain aspects of spiritual life in the metropolis, as if it looked at them in a fragmentary way, to then grasp through these fragments the holistic sense of the metropolitan experience.
La prima grande figura concettuale sulla quale Simmel si sofferma nel suo saggio riguarda l'intensificarsi del Nervenleben, la vita nervosa come prerogativa dell'esistenza nei confini della moderna metropoli.
The first concept on which Simmel stops his attention is that of what he calls the Nervenleben, that is to say, the life of the nerves, literally, as the figure that allows us to understand the attitude, the spiritual attitude that takes place within metropolitan life.
Sempre tramite un riferimento comparativo con la vita nella città di provincia, Simmel mostra come la moderna metropoli si distingue esattamente per l'accrescimento, l'accelerazione, l'intensificazione dei ritmi a cui vengono sottoposti gli abitanti della metropoli.
So through a comparison with the life in a provincial city, Simmel underlines how life in a metropolis is characterized by the constant increase, acceleration, intensification of the rhythms whereby the inhabitants of metropolis are brought to live.
La quantità e la rapidità delle esperienze a cui è sottoposto il cittadino metropolitano generano un'inattesa diversità nella qualità stessa della vita metropolitana rispetto a quella della città di provincia.
The quantity and speed at which and through which the citizen of metropolis is forced to live generate a qualitative difference in the life experience that this very citizen goes through as compared to a citizen of a provincial town.
I ritmi dell'esistenza nella metropoli sono per Simmel accuratamente misurati e monetizzati. Il tempo accelerato diventa la cifra della vita metropolitana moderna.
So the rhythms of existence in modern metropolis are carefully quantified and calculated so that acceleration becomes, Zimmel says, the main trait of life in the modern city.
Gli appuntamenti del lavoro, la specializzazione e la divisione del lavoro, i luoghi diversi da raggiungere nella città trafficata, fanno sì che l'individuo sia totalmente dipendente dall'accelerazione e dall'orologio.
So the work appointments, the places to be reached in order to conduct one's own work, all the commitments and so on and so forth, make so that the individual lives an accelerated life, the rhythm of which is rigidly calculated by the rhythm of the clock.
Anche in questo emerge chiaramente per Zimmel la contrapposizione fra la vita nella città di provincia e quella nella metropoli. Nella città di provincia abbiamo come riferimento abitudini e ripetizione. Nella città metropolitana invece un rinnovamento continuo, una fretta febbrile.
And in this too, Zimmel says, the difference between provincial life in a provincial town and life in the metropolis comes to the fore, in that whereas in the provincial town we have the repetition of the same rhythms, in metropolis we have a constant acceleration whereby everything is constantly renewed in the sense of being changed.
Ancora, l'abitante della città di provincia conserva e ripete le proprie abitudini, laddove invece l'abitante della metropoli tende a costruirle e a disfarle con inaudita rapidità.
So, even more than this, the inhabitant of a provincial town tends to keep and repeat his own habits, whereas the inhabitant of modern metropolis tends to build and destroy them with an unforeseen speed.
Se nella vita di provincia, della città di provincia, è dominante la sentimentalità, ossia una modalità di percezione e di esperienza delle sollecitazioni esterne per cui ci si abitua alla realtà, nella metropoli trionfa invece per Zimmel l'intelletto.
So, whereas in the provincial town, the tone of life that is predominant is that of sentimentality, that is to say, a way of life whereby one gets used to surrounding reality, little by little. The metropolis, what predominates is an intellectual approach to life.
Dobbiamo chiederci con Zimmel quale sia la figura tipica dell'abitante della metropoli moderna.
We must ask ourselves with Zimmel what's the typical figure of the inhabitant of modern city.
L'abitante per antonomasia delle Großstädte, delle metropoli, è per Zimmel il blasé.
So, the inhabitant par excellence of the Großstädte, of the metropolis, for Zimmel, is the blasé.
Il blasé è colui che più di ogni altro è sottoposto al Nervenleben, alla vita nervosa e accelerata nella modernità della metropoli.
So the blasé is the type that more than anybody else is subject to the Nervenleben, that is to say, the life of the nerves, this accelerated and stressing kind of life typical of modern city.
Il cittadino blasé è continuamente tempestato da sollecitazioni, nuove esperienze, ritmi iperrapidi e reagisce in un modo specifico, secondo Zimmel.
So the blasé citizen undergoes constantly the accelerated and stressful rhythms of modern city and reacts, Zimmel says, in a very particular way.
Il blasé vive nell'attutimento della sensibilità rispetto alla differenza fra le cose.
The blasé lives in the enfeeblement, come si dice, of his perception of reality, that is to say, of his perception of the difference between things.
Il significato e il valore delle differenze non è che non vengano percepite dal blasé, semplicemente lui avverte come irrilevanti le differenze e il significato delle molteplici esperienze.
So it's not that the blasé does not perceive the meaning and the value of differences between things, but that he perceives them in an enfeebled, he perceives them in a weakened way.
Il blasé, continuamente tempestato dalle esperienze e dalle novità metropolitane, reagisce con una sorta di incurante adattamento, non reagisce.
So the blasé was always under the thrust of the rhythm of modern life, reacts to this bombardment and by adapting himself and slowly losing his sensitivity to things.
L'euforia legata alla moltiplicazione degli stimoli esterni si capovolge così nel suo opposto, cioè nella sensazione tipica del blasé che tutto sia già stato vissuto, tutto sia effimero e illusorio.
So the euphoria, the enthusiasm caused by the bombardment of constant new stimuli translates itself in the fact that the blasé starts perceiving things as already seen, already done, breath, that is to say, of any interest.
Il blasé è perennemente sospeso tra vitalità e insignificanza, vive con emozione l'istante della nuova esperienza, ma subito tale istante si esaurisce non appena l'esperienza è terminata.
So the blasé is divided between vitalism and indifference, that is to say, he lives with great euphoria every new instant, but this very instant exhausted itself very quickly and thus the blasé loses interest into it.
E questo per Zimmel il segreto di quello che oggi chiamiamo consumismo o anche di quello che Zimmel stesso studia come fenomeno della moda nel suo importante testo del 1905 Philosophie der Mode, la filosofia della moda.
So this is, according to Zimmel, what we nowadays call consumerism, and which is the same mechanism, Zimmel submits, that is at work in the phenomenon of fashion, as Zimmel has underlined in his famous essay of 1905, The Philosophy of Fashion.
Proprio come il consumatore di oggi, il blasé di cui diceva Zimmel, può vivere soltanto se tiene vive aperte sempre nuove illusioni, nuove fantasticherie, nuove esperienze che possano realizzarsi nell'istante dell'esperienza vissuta.
So, like the blasé that Zimmel has described, so also the consumerist can live only insofar as he keeps generating all the time new illusions, new dreams, new desires that can be fulfilled in an instant.
Dalla figura del blasé, Zimmel ricava un altro concetto chiave della metropoli moderna, che è quello di distrazione.
From the figure of the blasé, Zimmel derives another important category typical of modern metropolis, that is the category of distraction.
la distrazione è quasi un organo di sopravvivenza dell'individuo nella metropoli moderna, perché gli permette di difendersi e di reagire rispetto agli innumerevoli stimoli esperienziali da cui è bombardato.
So distraction is almost a coping and defensive mechanism of the individual within the life of the modern metropolis, because it allows him to defend himself and thus survive from the various stimuli by which he's constantly bombarded.
Il già richiamato intelletto, tipico della vita metropolitana, è per Simmel ciò che permette alla distrazione di determinarsi nella vita dell'abitante della metropoli.
So what we have already quoted before, that is say intellect, is what allows the mechanism of distraction for the individual to be at work in his life in modern metropolis.
Un po' come il preconscio di cui dice Freud, l'intelletto è una zona neutra in grado di accogliere e disfare senza posa gli stimoli esterni, senza che mai essi vengano focalizzati in quanto tali.
In a way, like Freud's preconscious, so the intellect for Simmel is sort of neutral zone in which the individual is able to, on the one hand, accept but immediately neutralize all the stimuli that come to him from the outside.
Generando una sorta di mediocrità emotiva, l'intelletto e la distrazione permettono all'uomo metropolitano di muoversi nello sfavillio delle vetrine e degli annunci, nell'assordante caos dei rumori e delle parole.
By generating a sort of emotional mediocrity, intellect and distraction allow the blasé, the inhabitant of the modern metropolis, to move through the various lights and stimuli of modern city.
Nelle relazioni intersoggettive, la distrazione e l'intelletto si determinano poi nella vita metropolitana nella forma della diffidenza, della riservatezza e della distanza.
In the relation between men and men, the two forms of distraction and intellect translate themselves in the form of diffidence and
riservatezza
and
privacy.
Distance and privacy.
Nella città di provincia, dice Simmel, ci si conosce tutti e si ha un rapporto effettivo con ognuno. Domina la sentimentalità.
In the province town, Simmel says, everybody knows everybody, and everybody is confident about everybody, and what dominates is sentimentality.
Nella vita metropolitana, dove si incontrano ogni giorno migliaia di nuove persone, ciò non è possibile. E quindi si mantengono rapporti di distanza, freddi, o almeno freddi percepiti dall'abitante della provincia.
In the life of the metropolis, this is not possible because each person encounters every day thousands of people, and hence the relationships that he establishes with everybody are based on distance and on a kind of attitude that is perceived, at least by the inhabitant of the province, as characterized by coldness.
Questa distanza, questa diffidenza è percepita in primo luogo dall'abitante della provincia come mancata socializzazione, ma in realtà, dice Simmel, paradossalmente è la forma tipica della socializzazione nella città metropolitana.
So this distance is perceived by the inhabitants of the province as lack of socialization. And yet, Simmel says, it is paradoxically the main form of socialization within the modern metropolis.
il tipico predominio dell'intelletto nella vita metropolitana si evince, ad avviso di Simmel, da un altro aspetto importante.
And the typical preponderance of the intellect in metropolitan life can be seen, Simmel says, from another important aspect.
Questo aspetto riguarda i rapporti economici nella metropoli, dove domina un'economia differente rispetto a quella della città di provincia.
This aspect can be seen if we analyze, Simmel says, the economical relationships within metropolis, which are fundamentally different from those established in a provincial town.
Se nella città di provincia troviamo una relazione economica, affettiva e sentimentale fra l'artigiano e il cliente, che si conoscono e si relazionano fra di loro, ben altrimenti avviene nella metropoli.
If in provincial town we find a sentimental and personal relationship that determines economical relationships, for example, the relationship between the artisan and its customer that know each other and trust each other, things are not this way in the metropolis.
I rapporti economici nella metropoli sono modellati esclusivamente secondo gli algidi principi dell'utilitarismo, del dout des mercatistico.
Economical relationships in metropolis are regulated solely by utilitarian ideas, that is to say, by the principle of the do ut des, I give so that you give to me, typical of a utilitarian approach.
Scrive testualmente Simmel, la metropoli moderna vive quasi esclusivamente della produzione per il mercato.
Simmel says literally, and I quote, a modern metropolis lives solely in order to produce for the market.
Questo è possibile proprio in ragione del fatto che nella metropoli si produce distanza, spersonalizzazione, anonimato.
This is possible for the very fact that in the metropolis what is produced is distance, depersonalization and anonymity.
Domina cioè quella che Simmel chiama una mera neutralità oggettiva che fa sì che la relazione economica stessa si autonomizzi nella forma di un poderoso dispositivo anonimo, non personale.
So what dominates is what Simmel defines
mera neutralità oggettiva.
A mere objective neutrality that makes so that
che fa sì che i rapporti e relazioni economiche si spersonalizzino e diventino un dispositivo anonimo e oggettivo.
That makes so this mere objective neutrality that the interpersonal relationships get depersonalized and become part of an anonymous impersonal machinery.
Nella metropoli domina l'intelletto anche nella forma della ragione calcolante, il cui atteggiamento fondamentale si determina come sospeso fra giustizia formale e durezza spietata.
So in metropolis dominates intellect also in the form of calculating reason that manifests itself in the forms of cold justice and inexorable toughness.
Di qui uno dei principali paradossi della vita metropolitana per Simmel. L'individuo metropolitano astrattamente è onnipotente e concretamente è pressoché impotente.
And here come one of the many one of the paradoxes that Simmel has found in modern metropolis, that is to say, if we look at it abstractly, the individual in the metropolis is almighty, but concretely, in fact, he has no power whatsoever.
Appunto, per un verso, l'individuo metropolitano è sciolto dai tradizionali vincoli comunitari e religiosi. Può fare tutto ciò che vuole come individuo.
So, on the one hand, the metropolitan individual is totally unbound from, is totally free from the traditional ties, religious, social, political, that limited him in previous societies.
Ma poi, per un altro verso, egli è connesso ineludibilmente a processi oggettivi che trascendono il suo controllo e il suo volere, facendo di lui, dice Simmel, un granello di sabbia di fronte a un'oggettività data.
But on the other hand, and concretely, is then inextricably tied up,
come un granello di sabbia. Ah sì, è connesso a un meccanismo oggettivo.
Is connected in an inextricable way to an objective mechanism
che fa di lui un granello di sabbia di fronte a un'organizzazione immensa di cose.
That transforms him, as Simmel says, into a tiny cog in front of an immense anonymous organization of things.
La libertà nella metropoli tende a definirsi semplicemente come smarrimento del chiaro riconoscimento della propria identità sociale. L'individuo sparisce nella molteplicità della città.
Freedom in metropolis, Simmel says, becomes in fact the loss of social identity as part of a community. In fact, the individual disappears in the modern city.
Di qui uno dei paradossi della metropoli e a maggior ragione, come vedremo, dell'odierna metropoli cosmopolitana. Il fatto che l'individuo si trova in mezzo a milioni di suoi simili e si sente solo.
And here comes another paradox, which is at once a main trait of modern metropolis, which we will dwell more later. That is to say that in the middle of millions of other individuals, the individual feels himself always alone.
Scrive testualmente Simmel: da nessuna parte ci si sente così soli, abbandonati, come nel brulichio della metropoli.
Simmel writes, and I quote, nowhere in the world one feels so alone like in the very middle of the crowd of the metropolis.
Si potrebbero dire ancora molte cose sulla struttura del testo di Simmel, ma voglio ora soffermarmi brevemente, a partire sempre da Simmel, sulla cifra dell'odierna metropoli cosmopolitica.
One could say many more things reflecting on the very structure of the text of Simmel, but as for now, starting from these considerations, I wanna say a few things about the reality of modern days, of nowadays metropolis.
Certo, la metropoli odierna di cui siamo abitatori non può essere spiegata solo con le lenti interpretative di Simmel. Bisogna portare all'altezza, avrebbe detto Gramsci, il suo discorso.
Of course, the reality in which we live now cannot be read only through the lenses of Simmel, but as Gramsci would have said, we have to bring his reading to the height we've reached.
Potremmo dire, semplificando un po', che chi volesse capire l'odierna metropoli solo con le lenti di Simmel resterebbe miope, ma chi volesse comprenderla senza le lenti di Simmel resterebbe cieco.
We could say, using a metaphor, that whoever would want to understand nowadays reality only through the lenses of Simmel would remain myopic. However, whoever would totally renounce to use Simmel's lenses would be totally blind.
È indubbiamente vero che l'odierna metropoli cosmopolitica, più di quella di Simmel, si basa sul predominio dell'intelletto calcolante, sull'egemonia dell'economia di mercato e sulla spersonalizzazione dei rapporti.
It is absolutely true that nowadays metropolis, much more than the metropolis of the time of Simmel, is founded upon calculative reason, the predominance of market economy and the depersonalization of human relationships.
Le cosiddette odierne metropoli, che in realtà sono megalopoli senza metron, senza misura, si basano sulla frammentazione dell'individualità in atomi di consumo.
The so-called modern metropolis that in reality are megalopolis with no metron, that is to say, with no measure, are funded upon the fragmentation of individuality into atoms of consumerism.
Le singole individualità atomiche vivono isolate, evitano gli spazi pubblici o li frequentano con ostentato fastidio.
The singular atomized individualities live in an isolated way. They avoid public spaces, or if they are forced to go to public spaces, they abide them with clear impatience.
Sulle metropolitane, ad esempio, si ha paura a guardare il proprio vicino negli occhi e si ricorre ossessivamente ad apparati tecnici per evitare ogni relazione con l'altro.
In the subways, MRT in Singapore, for example, one tends to avoid to look at the other in the eyes, and in fact, one even uses technical devices to avoid to do so.
Appunto, l'analisi di Simmel è stata confermata dalla sociologia contemporanea, che ha parlato ad esempio di folla solitaria, the lonely crowd, Riesman, o ancora ha parlato di fall of public men, Richard Sennett.
In a certain way, Simmel's analysis has been confirmed by modern sociological scholarship, which has talked about lonely crowd,
Riesman,
and
Sennett, the fall of public man,
and Riesman, the fall of public man.
Mi ha molto colpito, piccola parentesi, qui a Singapore il fatto che non vi siano piazze, cioè l'antica agorà della polis greca in cui si intrattenevano relazioni di dialogo, di discussione.
I've been very struck, and I open a little parenthesis, coming here to Singapore, I was very struck to notice that there are no squares, the ancient agorà, which were also the place of public dialogue.
I cittadini delle odierne metropoli sono tutti come Robinson Crusoe, che è il grande mito della modernità.
The citizens of modern metropolis are all like Robinson Crusoe, that is in a way the archetypical character of modernity.
Robinson Crusoe è proiettato nel proprio individualismo e intrattiene relazioni con l'altro al solo fine di massimizzare il proprio utile ai danni del povero venerdì di turno.
Robinson Crusoe is closed within his own individualism and entertains any relation with the other only to increase his own benefits, damaging of course the poor Friday that comes his way.
L'analisi di Simmel sembra anche comprovata dall'aspetto specifico per cui l'odierna metropoli destruttura le vecchie comunità.
The analysis of Simmel seems to be proven also by the fact that nowadays metropolis de facto destructures old communities.
Destruttura le vecchie comunità, lascia gli individui isolati come atomi di consumo alla Robinson Crusoe e poi crea nuove comunità basate sul consumo stesso.
Destructures old communities, that is to say, isolate the individuals, making of them atoms of consumerism, and then reassembles these atoms in new communities determined by consumerism.
Pensiamo ad esempio ai centri commerciali che affollano le grandi metropoli, in cui si riproducono le piazze, gli antichi luoghi come le panetterie o i fornai, e si è accomunati tutti come individui dall'essere homines consumentes, consumatori.
We can think, for example, of the malls, the various malls that fill in the spaces of the cities, in which what is reproduced is, yes, the ancient agora with the various ancient activities such as bakeries and so on and so forth, but in which the common denominator is that everybody is there as what in Latin we can call
homines consumentes.
Homines consumentes, that is to say, men that are men insofar as they consume.
Il vecchio motto di Descartes, cogito ergo sum, sembra rideclinarsi nell'odierna metropoli cosmopolitica nel nuovo motto consumo ergo sum.
The old motto of Descartes, cogito ergo sum, I think, hence I am, can be restated in the modern metropolis as I consume, hence I am.
La nostra cosmopoli contemporanea, sulla linea di quello che già diceva Zimmer, sembra davvero presentarsi come la civiltà degli eremiti di massa, come diceva Gunther Anders.
So, our society, following the trace started by Zimmer, seems really to be configuring itself as the society of the mass hermits.
Un altro punto importante, e mi avvio alla conclusione, che prova la verità delle analisi di Zimmer, si trova nella mercificazione integrale degli spazi pubblici nell'odierna metropoli cosmopolitica.
And another important point, and with this I go towards my conclusion, an important point that proves furthermore Zimmer's analysis, is the present
present commodification
of public spaces.
In questo senso, le analisi di Zimmel possono essere fecondamente intrecciate con quelle di Marc Auger.
In this sense, the analysis of Zimmel can be fruitfully crossed with the analysis of Marc Auger.
Marc Auger ha parlato nei suoi testi dei non luoghi, non lieu. I non luoghi sono spazi eterotopici che presentano in forma ammaliante e utopica la realtà colonizzata dalla forma merce.
Marc Auger has spoken in his text of the non places, the non lieu. The non places are places that through eterotopy display in a how can I say
fantasmatische forma, no, in tedesco,
in a phantasmagorial form,
in a phantasmagorial form, la realtà colonizzata dalla forma merce,
present in a phantasmagorial form reality once it has been colonized by the effect of commodification.
Negli spazi dei non luoghi tutte le icone rilanciano la forma merce.
In the spaces of the non-spaces, all the images, all the icons, relaunch, repropose the general commodification.
proprio come la moda di cui diceva Simmel, che promette un look inimitabile all'individuo, ma poi promette la stessa cosa a tutto il mondo, qualcosa del genere capita qui in un luogo.
So exactly like for fashion, which as Simmel says, promises to each individual a unique look, but then proposes the same thing to everybody. The same thing happens with the non places.
I non luoghi presentano specifiche ed esotiche località, come i ristoranti etnici, come i luoghi super ricercati, ma poi li presentano tali e quali in tutte le metropoli del mondo.
So the non places present us with unique and exotic locations, such as, for example, ethnic restaurants or
luoghi ricercati,
particular and peculiar places, but then present these same places all over again, all over the world, in exactly the same form.
In questo senso, i non luoghi producono familiarità e addomesticamento, ci fanno sentire a casa nello spazio spersonalizzato e anonimo delle metropoli.
In this sense, the non places produce a sort of familiarity and domestication, that is to say, they make us feel alone in the unfriendly and depersonalized spaces of modern metropolis.
Essi trasformano in utopia l'esistente, trasformano cioè nell'atto stesso in cui sempre lo ripetono la realtà come sogno da realizzare.
They transform what is there, the existent, in utopia. That is to say, automatically transform reality that is there as what must still be realized.
In questo senso si può dire che con i non luoghi, nelle odierne metropoli globali, si è verificato il transito dal sogno di una cosa, di Marx, al postmoderno sogno delle cose, della realtà mercificata.
So in this way we can say that in the modern metropolitan non-places we witness the transition from Marx's dream of a thing to nowadays dream of things, that is to say, the transition to a totally commodificated reality.
In conclusione si può dire, con Simmel e oltre Simmel, che nelle odierne metropoli globalizzate il divenire mondo della merce coincide con il divenire merce del mondo.
To conclude, we can say with Simmel that in nowadays metropolis
il divenire mondo della merce coincide con il divenire merce del mondo.
The fact that that commodities become the world coincides with the fact that the entire world becomes just a commodity.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Diego. A very rich intervention. I'm not sure that I'm able to sum it up in a few words. Let me see what time it is. I don't want to torture you much longer, so I'll take 10 minutes myself just for my intervention, and I haven't prepared much. These are reflections that partly I presented in Bangkok a few months ago, that I kept thinking about. And on the trace given by first Giuseppe on the lack of measure, right, that characterizes globalization, and then on the suggestion put forth by Diego of modern city as characterized basically by what has become universal commodification. Do you think that this is a good formula to sum up your message? New modern metropolis as universal commodification of reality. I would like to very briefly talk about globalization again. Now we use this term, and it seems to us that it is a totally transparent term, right? When I ask my students, they always say globalization is good because it puts us in contact with people. That's it. It remains then always vague what the hell globalization actually means, and above all, how it works. Because that's, to me, the most important thing to understand what a sociological phenomenon actually is. You must understand what's the mechanism behind it. How does it actually work? Now, of course, one can go into an analysis of the production of goods in globalization. The fact, for example, that my chocolate is produced in Ecuador, where I've never been, and then is packed in Belgium and sold to me as French. This is, right, part of the mechanism of globalization. Or the fact that in Singapore, I'm wearing Uniqlo, that is a Japanese brand, but in fact it has been produced in Indonesia, and before coming to Singapore, it passed through Thailand. This is part of globalization as well, this mechanism. However, I think that all these mechanisms that have to do with the production are just what is needed to keep going the actual engine of globalization, that is the modern metropolis. Now, my reflection, again, as I said, I'm going to be very, very brief, is based on a few observations that I did myself through my traveling. I'm not a sociologist by formation. In fact, I'm a classical philologist that then devoted his time to philosophy. So I'm an amateur, so to say, in these things. But, you know, I have eyes to see and I observe certain things. I come from a super provincial town in simple terms. I come from a town of 2,000 people if you count chicken and pigs. Without that, we are maybe 900. And then move to different cities, first in northern Italy, in Perugia, still a medieval city, then Freiburg, another tiny medieval city. Then the first shock was Paris. Then from Paris, New York, then New York, Philadelphia already is a bit provincial, then Los Angeles, and then here, passing again through Rome. What I've noticed in all my pilgrimations is that, strangely enough, a city like Milan is more similar to Los Angeles in the rhythm of life, in the things people eat, in the way they live, than it is similar to the countryside around Milan. And still in a city like Milan, you have certain reminders of the fact that the city is ancient and belongs to a world that used to order itself around a set of values that was quite different from the way in which I perceive the world now. But if you jump from Los Angeles to Singapore, I dare you to show me substantial differences, even in terms of buildings that could remind you of something, of a different way of being in the world that has been there in the past. I've been to Bangkok then from here, and what I've seen again is the same phenomenon. You have, that is to say, the same multiplied in different place of the globe appearing always, again, as I said, as the same. This made me reflect on globalization. And I wonder, what is it then, globalization? I think that if you want to be philologically accurate, we should say that globalization is, in fact, metropolization. I've read that pretty much in the span of 30 years from now, 300 million people are going to move to cities. So cities are going to keep expanding. The countryside is disappearing. And yet the countryside in each nation, in each place of the globe, are the places in which stubbornly differences are kept. If you go to the countryside in Malaysia is quite different from the countryside where I come from. The way of life is quite different, even though, yes, it's determined by the rhythms of nature. But overall, you have a totally different experience. If you jump from Singapore to, say, Paris, except the language, there are not many differences in the end. So, metropolis is really the form of the world. On the one hand, globalization is metropolization. One thing. But what does this mean? It means then that metropolization is homogenization. Wherever you go, you find the same, the same, the same, the same. And this is true not only if we look at an abstract analysis, but even looking at the buildings. The so-called archistar, they call them, right? Hmm? Starchitects? Yeah, starchitects, archistars, whatever. That produce the same buildings that you can find here in London. I mean, the horror there, the thing at One North, or even worse, the Star Vista thing, that can be found in London. I wouldn't be surprised. Does it have anything that is particularly Southeast Asian? No. If you put that in Oslo, okay, so they put it there. I call it IKEA architecture. Like, you dismantle it in one place and reassemble it in another place. Done, boom. So homogenization that takes shape in the buildings takes shape even in what we drink. When I arrived here in Singapore, I felt immediately at home. You know why? 7-Eleven. I found 7-Eleven everywhere in the US. I arrived to Singapore, boom, 7-Eleven again. Same stuff. They sell the same food, moreover. That's the crazy thing, that you would think that food is different because, okay, 7-Eleven is still 7-Eleven, but food is different because we're in Singapore. No, same food. So homogenization takes a quite evident, I think, form, which we don't need to go analyze the rhythms of life. We just need to see the places in which we live and the stuff we eat and the places in which we buy things, okay? Now, what does this bring as a result? Well, two things I would say. One, the fact that space in this modern metropolis is always more or less divided up in the same way. It's always determined by the same vectors, which are basically driven by efficiency. You must be brought in the quickest way from your sleeping place to your working place and back, stopping at the supermarket maybe if you need to buy something, but be quick and then go back home. And repeat the circle 5 days a week. Then during the weekend, if you are part of the developed world, you can go to Bali and have a vacation for 2 days, and then you come back to Changi, and at Changi you have your very efficient MRT, which will bring you back to your little cave where you live, right? And according to how rich you are, you can go to Bali more often or less often, and you are going to have a more comfortable or less comfortable cave. And the same thing is in Milan, is in Moscow, is in New York, whatever. Wherever you go, you find the same kind of life on the one hand. So space divided according to efficiency and productivity, so that the individual is always channeled as a sort of lab rat on the one hand. So space management driven towards productivity. And then the fact that even in ancient cities, I know that this is particularly true in China, I've heard, even in ancient cities, sometimes you have the displacement, if not the elimination, tout court, of traces of the past. This may seem something rational to do. Why do you want to keep old ruins there in place and change, and not change for the better? Why not to get rid of the old neighborhoods of Bangkok? which they're doing now, right? If you go to Bangkok, you see that old neighborhoods are being destroyed to make room for yet another mall, right? Why not to do that? Well, the thing is this. I was telling you before about Milan and the fact that a European city like Milan or Paris or Rome, even though they are metropolis by now, have still in them an element that doesn't allow us to perceive them as totally homogenized with the rest. Well, what is this element? Crisis of the past. Unfortunately, we go to Europe oftentimes, or to ancient Chinese cities, or to ancient Japanese cities, as tourists. So we admire these things, oh, so nice, so cute, so beautiful, and then we go back home, and we can see that we're taking a picture with the Colosseum behind us. An habit that I find quite curious. Why would you take pictures of yourself all over the world with the monument behind you? Well, maybe people don't trust you that you've been there. I don't know. In any case. But very few of us reflect on the fact that if you look carefully at those traces of the past, those traces of the past are still alive in a way. In which way? Well, in the sense that they bear witness to the fact that all the human beings, like us, have lived in a different way back then. This means that all the possibilities of being have been there. By eliminating the past altogether, that is to say, destroying the buildings of the past, or by reducing them to touristic attractions, you neutralize this possibility. So, going back to the metropolis, what is it, the other trait of this metropolis? Homogenization is also flattening up of the past. Elimination of the potentialities contained in the past. In turn, this, I think, generates something that I don't know whether it's going to be the case, but I fear could be the case. It generates the tyranny of the present, and by this I mean the fact that the present, not having a point, a contradictory point of comparison that could be the past, will keep repeating itself always as the same present, and the only difference would be the increase in the quantity of this present that, as Diego says, is characterized mainly by commodities. So the future will be different from the present only because whereas now with this thing I can only call and make pictures and maybe take short movies, one day this thing will make me coffee and maybe will produce me a virtual girlfriend. But the logic will remain the same. Exploitment, efficiency, and more exploitment in a mechanism in which the individual, from having started to be a consumer, will end up being totally the consumed. So that's my intervention. I could go deeper and talk about the past in Heideggerian terms with the concept of Wiederholung, but I won't bother you any longer, also because I need to shut up here, the fact that I've spoken three times, basically. Okay, so I leave the floor to you and to the provocateur who wants to punch us.